Good morning, and welcome to New Hanover County Schools The Morning Show. I'm Hannah Bolick.
And I'm Julia Romero. This is the week of February 13th through the 19th.
We have a superb show in store for you today, which will entertain and educate.
Safety is the name of the game for today's show. We have two special features, one on pedestrian safety and one on bicycle safety. Both are packed with great information for the young and old alike.
We also have a fascinating episode of Science Nation, which is brought to us by the National Science Foundation. In it, we learn how scientists are turning pig manure into asphalt.
And we have the latest edition of Snapshots. We'll take a look back at some of the fun and positive happenings from across our school district.
But first, let's check in with our news anchor, Allison Helms, for a look at this morning's Your School News headlines. Good morning, Allison.
Good morning, Hannah and Julia, and welcome everyone to Your School News here on The Morning Show. Topping the headlines this week, school district provides an overview of signature programs at traditional high schools. Laney High School inducts new members into its Hall of Fame, and Parsley Elementary alumni return to school to open time capsule. I have all those stories and more coming up later in the show.
Thanks, Allison.
Okay, get ready to laugh because it is time for our joke of the week.
Students in Ms. Clayton's Honors Drama class at Ashley High School have performed these jokes for the morning show.
Now you can start each day off with a dose of humor.
Here's our joke of the week.
A struggling zoo's main attraction, a gorilla, dies right before the season opens. So to keep the zoo from going under, they hire a man to dress up as that gorilla. Soon enough, the man in the gorilla costume becomes even more popular than the original gorilla. As a publicity stunt, he decides to climb a tree and hang from a branch over the lion's den. Well, as he's doing this, the branch breaks and he falls into the lion's den, and he's screaming, "Help! Help! Someone help!" And as he hits the ground, the lion pounces on him and says, "Shh! It'll get us both fired."
Another fabulous joke. Thank you, Ashley Honors Drama.
And now it's time for a staple here on The Morning Show, This Week in History. Our Grand Master of Historical Knowledge has all the headlines from past times in This Week in History, brought to you by Kidsville News.
Welcome to This Week in History. I'm your historical host, William Shager, covering all the colorful and amazing events that have left their mark on history's timeline. This is the week of February 13th through February 19th. February 13th, 1861. The earliest military action to be revered with a Medal of Honor award is performed by Colonel Bernard J.D. Irwin, an assistant army surgeon. He successfully led 14 men on a mission to rescue 60 troops who were trapped on an Apache pass. February 14th, 1929, Alexander Fleming discovers penicillin when he noticed that a mold in his lab was killing bacteria. He identified the mold and introduced penicillin as a cure for bacterial infections. February 15th, 1903, toy store owner and inventor Morris Midgetum places two stuffed bears in his shop window, advertising them as teddy bears. Before long, other toy manufacturers began turning out copies of Mitchum's stuffed bears, which soon became a national childhood institution. February 16, 1923. In Thebes, Egypt, English archaeologist Howard Carter enters the sealed burial chamber of the ancient Egyptian ruler King Tut. The tomb was and remains the best preserved royal tomb ever discovered. February 17, 1972. The Volkswagen Beetle breaks the world car production record held for more than four decades by the Ford Company's iconic Model T. Finally, your week in history tidbits. February 18, 1885, Mark Twain publishes his famous and controversial novel, The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn. Twain saw Huck's story as a sequel to the earlier book, The Adventures of Tom Sawyer. February 19, 1473, Nicholas Copernicus is born in Toruń, a city in north-central Poland. The father of modern astronomy, he was the first modern European scientist to propose that Earth and other planets revolve around the sun. That's This Week in History, your ultimate source for those key moments in time. I'm William Shaker. Thanks for stopping by.
This Week in History is brought to you by Kidsville News, a fun and effective learning resource for children, teachers, and parents. Kidsville News is always free. Copies are delivered every month to every elementary school in the New Hanover County school system.
And join us next time for another journey through time as we explore the fun, fascinating, entertaining, and educational facts that make up This Week in History.
We have plenty more of the morning show ahead, including Science Nation and this week's lunch menu.
Stay tuned. We'll be right back. I hate when I just have to smile.
Test you. Try to break your will. But however loud the loudness gets, however many cheese puffs may fly, you're the driver, the one in control. Stand firm. Just wait. And move only when you hear the click that says they're buckled in for the drive. Never give up till they buckle up.
Looks like it's done.
Don't let salmonella get funky with your chicken. On average, 1 in 6 Americans will get a foodborne illness this year. You can't see these microbes, but they might be there. So learn the right temperature to cook each type of meat. Keep your family safe at foodsafety.gov.
I remember how much you said you liked mine.
Oh.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. There are thousands of teens in foster care who would love to put up with you.
Welcome back to The Morning Show. I'm Hannah Bolick.
And I'm Julia Romero.
As we mentioned in the open, today we focus on safety.
We start with a special feature for younger students and their parents, as well as anyone who could use a refresher on bicycle safety.
Here are Xander and Elizabeth to show us how to bike safe and bike smart.
Bike safe, bike smart.
Hi, my name is Xander.
And my name's Elizabeth.
Over the next few minutes, we're gonna have some fun and talk about some pretty important stuff.
Some of it you've heard before, but it never hurts to hear it again.
And again.
And again. So here we go. This is about you, your bike, and the rules of the road.
Cause we want you to bike safe and bike smart.
Bike safe, bike smart.
As long as we're on the subject of smart, let's start with your head.
Good idea. Your head is where your brain lives, and you need your brain for a lot of things.
Did you know that just falling off your bike is enough to get a serious brain injury? So play it safe. Wear your helmet every time you ride. It can reduce the risk of head injury by up to 85%.
And that's a lot. The helmet should be snug on your head and sit flat. The straps should form a V under your ear, and the chin strap should also be snug. Two fingers should fit in between your eyebrow and your helmet.
Also, make sure your helmet meets safety standards. Look for a sticker that says CPSC. This stands for the Consumer Product Safety Commission.
Now that your head and brain are protected,
we can talk about how to ride safely. Did you know that bikes are considered vehicles?
Meaning you have to follow the same rules as someone driving a car.
That means when you ride in the street, ride in a straight line with traffic on the right side of the road. Riding against traffic is dangerous. It puts you where the driver of a car isn't expecting you. And if you're riding with friends, always ride single file. And here's something else to remember. Always obey traffic lights and signs, and pay attention to lane markings.
When you see one of these, stop. When you see one of these, yield. Traffic might be coming from one side or the other.
Now, since your bike doesn't come with turn signals,
use your hands.
But always check for traffic before you turn. Do this to turn left, this to turn right. Also, some states allow you to do this to turn right, and do this to stop.
Did you know that 70% of car bicycle crashes happen at driveways or intersections?
So before you enter a street, stop, look left, right, then left again, and use caution at intersections. Be careful. Don't be a statistic.
Hey. Now a word about staying alert.
If you're riding your bike, leave your headphones at home or stick them in a backpack, because if you put them on your head, you won't be able to hear the traffic around you.
Bike safe, bike smart.
Here are a few other things to remember to make your next ride a safe one.
Communicate with motorists by making eye contact or waving. That way both of you know you can see each other. Don't swerve in and out of parked cars, and always ride far enough away to avoid the unexpected.
Like eating a car door.
Always check behind you before turning or changing lanes.
Be courteous to pedestrians.
Keep your eyes open for things on the road, like litter, potholes, gravel, railroad tracks, and storm drains.
Can you see me?
How about me? It's more difficult to ride at night, but if you have to, make sure you can be seen.
Check this out. I'm wearing white, but it's not enough because I'm still difficult to see.
No matter what time of day you ride, always wear bright clothing. But at night, you really need to wear reflective or retroreflective gear. If you don't have any, buy some retroreflective tape and put it on your shoes, your jacket, and your helmet. It helps reflect light back to the driver of a car.
Make sure your bike has reflectors.
And you need a headlight and a taillight. That's the best way to get noticed in the dark. And it's the law.
Remember, the sooner a driver can see you and recognize you, the sooner they can react.
Thanks for all that great information, Xander and Elizabeth.
Keep these tips in mind when you're out biking, and remember to stress them if you have young bikers with you.
All right, it's time now to send it over to the news desk for more Your School News and our news anchor, Allison Helms. Good morning, Allison.
Good morning, and welcome to Your School News on the Morning Show. I'm Allison Helms. New Hanover County Schools hosted three informational events for parents of 8th grade students that provided an overview of various signature programs that are available through our traditional high schools and the Career Readiness Academy at Moseley. With a complete report on this event is YSN reporter Bridget Donovan.
Parents were thrilled to come to New Hanover County Schools' informational meetings, which provided overviews of each signature program available through traditional high schools and the Career Readiness Academy at Moseley. Parents who attended heard general information on each signature program, listened to representatives from each program, and received information important to planning their child's pathway.
Teachers report that they are looking for five things on those applications. The most important thing they're going to look at is your transcript, how hard you've worked, what your grades are. They're going to want to see your body of work over the 3.5 to 4 years that you have been in high school. They're going to take a look at that transcript, your grade point average, your rank, and that's going to be a big part of their deciding factors.
Parents and students learned that the Marine Science Academy is a fun way to make a splash in education. It is available through Eugene Ashley High School and offers students a unique experience with marine biology and oceanography. The International Bachelor Organization is offered at Hoggard High School and aims to develop caring young people that help to create a better and more peaceful world through respect.
Student in eighth grade who's wanting to apply, open choice, or if they're already districted for Hoggard, if they're wanting to apply for the pre-DP, they need to make sure that they've attended a phase one informational session. Our last one of this year will be March 7th at Hoggard in our media center, 7 p.m. It's on our website as well.
The Science, Technology, Engineering, and Math Academy is available at Laney High School and aims towards educating students by providing educational opportunities that improve skills in science, mathematics, biomedical technology, and engineering. New Hanover High School's Lyceum Academy is a 2-year program offered to students and is in an intense academic atmosphere. While the Career Readiness Academy at Mosley is a career technical education school that offers student partnerships with community businesses. These sessions were designed specifically for parents, while eighth grade students will receive the same presentations at their middle schools in coming months during the school day. For additional information, parents can contact the schools to get additional information about these programs. Reporting for your school news, this is Bridget Donovan.
Leading up to one of Laney High's boys basketball game, the school held their annual Hall of Fame induction ceremony. Honorees this year ranged in age and sport. The group included a pair of Division I athletes, a well-respected softball coach, and key members to Laney's success in basketball and tennis. Selected this year for Laney's Hall of Fame were Terrence Williams. Williams was an explosive runner who went on to play college football at Wake Forest. Jabbar Dickerson, who was second on all-time scoring list at Laney and was part of the Bucks' run to the 4A East Regional Basketball Championship. Softball coach Fred Chip Adams. Adams has been a teacher to both players and students. Aaron Teague. Teague had an impressive softball career at Laney, which turned into an opportunity to play at Villanova. And Laney's final Hall of Fame selection this year was Chris Menocal. Menocal competed in the individual 4A state tennis championship during the 1992 season. The students at Forest Hill Elementary have been studying the Chinese culture this past few weeks, leading to a huge parade they threw in honor of the Chinese New Year. This year's Chinese New Year occurred on January 28th. A unique thing about the Chinese New Year is that every year has an assigned animal or branch. This year's animal is the rooster, one of 12, the others being the rat, ox, tiger, rabbit, dragon, snake, horse, goat, monkey, dog, and pig. To celebrate, a few students at Forest Hills opted for wearing quipos, which are traditional Chinese clothing used in important celebrations. Students also got a chance to participate in the tradition of giving red envelopes, which in Chinese culture is a sign of gratitude and good luck. Overall, the students at Forest Hills Elementary had an amazing time learning and participating in the festivities that come with the Chinese New Year. For all the latest on New Hanover County Schools, join us weekdays at 5:30 p.m. here on Time Warner Cable Channel 5 and Charter Cable 191. For your school news, a complete half hour of all the latest news and information from New Hanover County Schools. Now back to our host.
Thanks, Allison. We continue our show with Science Nation from the National Science Foundation. This feature takes a dynamic, entertaining look at the research and the researchers that will change our lives.
From the latest inventions to studies that could change the way we perceive the world, Each episode is packed with fascinating information.
Visit a pig farm, and you will see and smell for yourself one of a pig farmer's biggest headaches is dealing with the mess.
We generate 43 billion gallons of swine manure in the world every year.
Which is not to say all this waste has to go to waste. Civil engineer Ellie Finney sees opportunity in pig manure, like a road stretching out in front of her.
Typically you see asphalt used on the road, the black gooey, you know, sticky things on the road. That's made from petroleum. So this material we're making is a new product made out of pig manure, which we have a lot of it in the United States.
Finney says pig waste is particularly rich in oils that are very much like petroleum. Too low grade to make gasoline, but maybe just right for where the rubber meets the road. With support from the National Science Foundation, she and a team at North Carolina Agricultural and Technical State University are making a sticky binder out of pig manure.
And we call it bioadhesive.
This process is only 56 cents per gallon to process. So very low cost, high impact.
Mix it with some rocks and you get asphalt. Nano engineer Daniel Oldham says it's critical this new material is just as durable as the asphalt used on roads now. So they're putting these samples through some rigorous tests.
Imagine a car traffic driving on top of this, putting on a load. We want to know if this thing's going to fall apart when this car comes on top of it, or if it's going to be so hard that when a car goes on top, it'll actually form cracks.
It simulates the truck traffic going back and forth, like 20,000 pass. We tested, is it gonna rot too much, like sagging? It shouldn't rot, and also it shouldn't crack at low temperature.
So far, the tests have been a success, so much so that Finney and partners have set up a company called Bioadhesives Alliance.
This one actually passed DOT spec.
Down the road, they hope to see their asphalt everywhere raw materials are abundant.
In Chile, there was a hog farm that was living near a village, and they had so much manure that their manure was spilling over into the people's water supplies. So they're literally drinking the stuff and they were getting sick. China has 10 times the amount of manure we do. So I mean, if we can take that manure away, you know, and process it and get something valuable out of it, I mean, this could really make a difference.
We think it's scalable and cost-wise it's profitable. Our vision is to help the farmer and help the construction industry, both sides. We see a win-win approach in the solution.
Swine bioadhesives. Before you poo-poo this as a stinky idea, rest assured, the smelly stuff is filtered out during the processing. The farmer can even use the leftovers as fertilizer. The idea smells like a rose to me, figuratively, anyhow. For Science Nation, I'm Miles O'Brien.
That was another interesting segment of Science Nation. It was neat to see that the research was happening right here in North Carolina.
Yes, and it would be a huge boon for the environment if they are successful at making pig manure useful.
Yep, maybe it will be a cheaper way to make roads and we can finally relieve some of the traffic congestion.
One can only hope.
It's time to take a quick break. Stay tuned, we'll be right back.
Cherish every day. Consider adopting from a shelter. Shelters are the best places to find a new pet. That's where you'll discover healthy, loyal, and loving animals, eager to become a part of your family. A person is the best thing to happen to a shelter pet. So bring home your new buddy today. To find out more, visit theshelterpetproject.org.
Hart, what's going on?
I'm leaving.
Why? What did I do?
Not enough.
You constantly ignore me. You barely eat anything healthy. You're half as active as you used to be. The pressure is just too much. I quit. Okay, I get it. I'll do better. Just please, don't leave. Okay, but remember, if I go, you go.
Listen to your heart. Don't let it quit on you. Uncontrolled high blood pressure could lead to stroke, heart attack, or death. Get yours to a healthy range before it's too late.
Our world today is changing faster than ever before. Career and technical education provides real-world learning experiences for students to gain a head start in pursuing their choice of career in college or by going straight into the workforce. Students can receive certifications in a variety of different fields, such as communications, cosmetology, or carpentry. Occupations stemming from career and technical education are some of the fastest growing in today's economy. Learn more about career and technical education at www.ctemonth.org.
Welcome back to The Morning Show. Each month, we are thrilled to spotlight an individual school's Teacher of the Year. In this segment entitled A-Plus Teachers, we take the time to get to know a little bit about the teacher's background and get an understanding of their philosophy of teaching that earned them their school's honor of Teacher of the Year. This morning, we feature Wrightsboro Elementary School's Teacher of the Year, Samantha Keller.
I grew up in Brooklyn, New York, so I'm a product of New York City public schools, and I just had a great kindergarten teacher. She was a first-year teacher, and she really inspired me to get into teaching, and ever since then, I've wanted to be a teacher. I had a chalkboard in my classroom, and when I was in high school, I worked at an after-school program, so I've just really always known that teaching was what I wanted to do. My philosophy towards teaching is really creating a loving environment with a lot of positive behavior implementations and fostering a love of learning onto my students. I want them to be really excited learners. I get to stay up to date with all the different innovations and new research-based programs because I'm a University of North Carolina Wilmington graduate student right now, and I'm also in the National Boards cohort here at Wrightsboro. So doing both of those things, I've been able to really stay focused and up to date with what's happening in education. I always send home a weekly newsletter to increase parent involvement within the classroom. I try to let my parents know that we have an open communication. They can check my website. We can use the phone. I also use Class Dojo and the messaging system. And they have a similar to a Facebook story post. So I like to take pictures and show what we're learning in the classroom so the parents can just get that update on their phone and just see, oh, today they're working on base 10 numbers and things like that. Wrightsboro is so amazing. We have so many different technological resources. So I use our smart board in almost any lesson to incorporate technology. I have an overhead projector, and we use Class Dojo, so our behavior system is based on technology. We're hooked up to RAS Kids, which is a reading program on technology, Discovery Education, and Science Tech Book, just kind of bringing in all of our educational aspects along with our behavioral aspects into technology. And the students love it. We have 4 iPads in our classroom, so they're able to work with vocabulary and reading on the iPads too. At Wrightsboro, I am the head Girls on the Run coach, and I try to do 2 seasons every school year. The past 2 school years since I've been in grad school, I've just done 1 season, done the spring season, but I absolutely love it, especially because I'm a second grade teacher. It gives me a great opportunity to meet the 3rd, 4th, and 5th grade girls in our school and just really create an amazing opportunity for them to have self-confidence and also set goals and achieve them, like running a 5K. And the parent involvement that comes with Girls on the Run is amazing. We have 50, 60 people at our 5K cheering us on, and it's such an overwhelming feeling.
Thanks, Ms. Keller. We have so many great teachers here in the New Hanover County school system. It's great to learn about them.
All right, it's time now for this week's lunch menu. This is the menu for Monday, February 13th through Monday, February 20th.
On Monday, February 13th, make your lunch fun with a chicken parmesan sandwich or have a fiesta with a beef taco with Spanish rice or enjoy a classic cheeseburger. No matter which entree, let the party continue with barbecue pinto beans and a frozen fruit cup.
Then, on Tuesday, February 14th, make haste to the lunch for a pork chop sandwich, a grilled cheese sandwich, or enticing stuffed crust pizza. Side items include tasty vegetable soup, tater tots, and applesauce.
On Wednesday, February 15th, sit down at lunch with your friends and enjoy chicken fried rice with an egg roll, amazing cheesy breadsticks, or pork barbecue with scrumptious hush puppies and slaw. Choose from an assortment of sides including pasta salad, glazed carrots, and tangy mandarin oranges.
On Thursday, February 16th, chow down on nachos grande, fantastic fish nuggets, or popcorn chicken with the choice of cornbread, muffin, or dinner roll. Complete your awesome meal with black bean and corn salad, a North Carolina sweet potato, and diced pears.
Then, on Friday, February 17th, stuff yourself silly with spaghetti with a breadstick, roasted chicken with a biscuit and gravy, or a super deluxe chicken sandwich. Continue your tummy expansion with a macaroni salad, a delicious baked potato, and mixed fruit.
Finally, on Monday, February 20th, shake off those Monday morning blues at lunch with a chicken filet sandwich, delectable lasagna roll-up with a breadstick, or corn dog nuggets. Complement your entree with the black-eyed peas and succulent diced peaches.
And there you have the lunch menu for the week. In addition to those items, milk, a garden salad, fresh fruit, French bread pizza, and a peanut butter and jelly combo will be made available daily.
So many delicious choices. Don't forget, you can also start your day off with a healthy and hearty breakfast at school.
We now bring our focus back to safety with another special feature.
Earlier, we covered bicycle safety, and now we have a feature covering an equally important topic, pedestrian safety.
Crossing guard, Mrs. Smith, her students, and Willie Whistle all work together to bring you these important tips.
Hello, my name is Mrs. Smith, and I'm a crossing guard. One of my jobs is to make sure young people cross the street safely. It's easy to be safe as long as you follow a few basic rules. I'm going out to meet some of my young friends now. Why don't you come along? I think you learned some great new things and have fun while you do. Here are my friends now. Hi, kids.
Hi, Mrs. Smith.
Now, before we get started, I'd like for you to meet the real teacher, Willie Whistle.
Hi, I'm Willie Whistle with an important message about crossing streets. Until you get older, about 11 or 12 years old, it's always best to cross the street at the corner with an adult you trust. But crossing guards, law enforcement officers, our parents and grandparents, along with crosswalks and traffic signals, aren't always there when we need them. So, Mrs. Smith and I are going to show you how to cross the street even when there is no help around. I want you to meet some friends of mine. Meet Lara, Sam, and Christina.
Hi.
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 Lara, Sam, and Christina are friends of mine because they know the right way to cross streets.
Would you like to learn the safe way?
The way we do it, it isn't hard.
Actually, it's kind of easy.
Cool. Now, the first thing we're going to learn about is curbs. Lara, if you want to be a safe street crosser, what do you do whenever you come to a curb? Or the edge of the road if there isn't a curb?
You stop.
Sam, what do you do when you come to a curb?
You stop.
Christina, what do you do when you come to a curb?
Ooh, you stop.
When you come to the curb or the edge of the road if there isn't a curb, you stop?
Always.
Every time, you always stop.
Stopping at the curb or the edge of the road when there is no curb is the first important thing to remember.
You're absolutely correct. You stop every time. There may be cars coming and you don't want them to hit you. There may be a car coming from the left, or there may be a car coming from the right. So, you look to the left, and you look to the right, and then you look to the left again, just to make sure.
Thanks, Willie. Does everybody understand?
Yes!
Before going into the street for any reason, when you come to the curb at the edge of the road, if there is no curb, you stop. Then you look to your left, then you look to your right, and you look to your left again. Do not go into the street until you're sure no cars are coming. Just to be sure that you know your left from your right, let's have everyone make an L with their left hand. See, L is for left hand. Now everybody wave your left hand. That's great. Now your right hand. Let's wave the right hand real hard. Keep waving it. Really hard. That's good. Now let's wave again. Left hand. Right hand. Left hand.
Lara, would you like to show us how to cross safely?
Sure. Come on, guys. Okay, don't forget to stop at the curb or at the edge of the road if there isn't a curb. Then we look to the left, to the right, and to the left again. If a car is passing, we wait till it's gone, look to the left, the right, and the left again. Okay, we're clear. Let's go.
Great job. Thanks, Lara. Christina, now it's your turn. Will you show us how to do it?
Sure.
First, stop at the curb. Then, look to the left and to the right. But there is a car coming. So, you wait until it passes and start again. Look to the left, look to the right, look to the left again. The street is clear, and it's okay to cross.
That was excellent, Christina. Just remember to always stop and look left, right, left every time you cross the street.
I will.
Thanks, Christina. Everybody with us so far?
Yes!
I thought you would be. Now, what do you think you do if there are cars parked on the street? You stop at the curb, but you can't really see if a car is coming or not. It's kind of different, isn't it? Sam, would you show us what to do in this case?
Well, I step to the curb and stop and check to make sure that the parked cars are not running and are empty. Then I step to the outside edge of the parked cars and stop. If there's a car coming, I step back and wait until it passes. Then I walk out to the edge again and look left and right and left until I don't see any more cars coming.
Good. Thanks, Sam.
Will we please go over the three basic things to remember?
First, always stop at the curb or the edge of the road if there isn't a curb before you step off the sidewalk. Second, after you stop at the curb, always look to the left and to the right and to the left again until there are no cars coming. Third, if cars are parked on the street, always go to the edge of the parked cars where you can see and stop before looking left, right, and left. If you see a car coming from any direction, wait until it passes and then look left, right, and left again until there are no cars coming each time you look. And that's it.
Thanks, Willie Whistle and Miss Smith. Those were excellent tips.
All right, everyone get a pen and paper ready. It's time for our morning show math question. This is a challenging problem for you to solve at home. We'll give you the question now and then solve it for you after a break. So put on your thinking caps and get ready to solve our question because here it is. Okay, we hope you got that down. Spend a minute working it out and we will have the answer after this short break.
Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
One day, when the glory comes, it will be ours.
Dr. King, what's your next move?
A march from Selma to Montgomery.
Selma is loud for every man, woman, and child.
We will not wait any longer.
In front of a crowd.
Mine eyes have seen the glory. Glory, glory, hallelujah.
Thank you. You got a king?
Go fish!
In your face, in your face!
The smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life. Take time to be a dad today.
When I have an asthma attack, I feel scared. Sometimes my parents have to take me to the hospital. I feel like a fish with no water.
You know how to react to their asthma attacks. Here's how to prevent them. Call 1-866-NO-ATTACKS. Visit www.noattacks.org or call your doctor. Because even one attack is one too many.
Welcome back to The Morning Show. I'm Hannah Bolick.
And I'm Julia Romero.
Before the break, we showed you our Morning Show math question.
Were you able to solve it correctly? Here is Elizabeth Crace, math teacher at Murray Middle School, with the solution.
Good morning. It's now time to see what our math problem of the day is today. We are trying to estimate to the nearest tenth the square root of 55. To find the square root of 55, I need to figure out what two consecutive integers it falls in between. Consecutive would mean in order, and integers is a whole number. So if I look at this, I know this falls in between the square root of 49 and the square root of 64. Well, the square root of 49 is 7, and the square root of 64 is 8. So I know the square root of 55 fits somewhere between the square root of 7 and the square root of 8. Well, if I look at this, this is only 49 is only 6 digits away from here. So it's minus 6 over here on this side. And on this side, it's actually 9 digits away. So I know that I'm closer to the square root of 49, which is 7. And I know that I'm a little bit further away here. It's not quite half. So my estimate is going to be about 7.4. I can check if I'm correct by multiplying 7.4 times 7.4. because the square root means what two numbers multiplied by themselves equal the square root of that. So 4 times 4, 16. 4 times 7, 20 and 29. I'm going to bring down my 0 whenever you multiply. Make sure your second row you have a 0. And again, doing the same, 7 times 4. And 7 times 7 is 49. And my 2 is 51. And I'm out of board space, but that's okay. So 7, 4, 5. So I ended up doing this, and I was out of board space, but I think you all can figure out here. 6, 7, 4. So I got to 54.76. Remember, there are two places after the decimal. So I'm gonna go two places after. And I've estimated back to 54.76, which is close to 55. So an estimate of the square root of 55 is 7.4. And now, back to our morning show.
We hope you enjoyed our morning show math problem and we got those brain juices flowing.
Each week, we'll feature a new problem for you to solve.
We now have our February segment of Snapshots.
In Snapshots, we take quick looks at some of the positive things going on around our school system.
From fun projects to school-wide events to guest speakers and fabulous field trips, there are so many great things for our schools to celebrate.
Hogarth's Drafting Engineer 2 students completed a 3D modeling project in which they created Viking-themed cookies, cookie cutters using the Autodesk Inventor software and a 3D printer to create actual prototypes. They also baked cookies using the printed designs.
Girls from Virgo and Williston attended a private screening of Hidden Figures and participated in a STEM career workshop and panel discussion. The panel was comprised of women in STEM careers, including a physician, a nurse, an engineer, a technology manager, and a technology teacher.
Ted Davis Jr., member of the North Carolina House of Representatives, visited Carolina Beach Elementary School. Students in Mrs. Bazemore's first grade class asked him questions about his job and making rules for the state.
Coddington Elementary celebrated the 100th day of school with a variety of activities. The first graders from Miss Heather Gregory's class dressed up as 100-year-olds for the occasion.
Castle Hayne Elementary received a Window of Opportunity grant sponsored by Duke Energy. The money will be put to good use integrating visual art and science to make an outdoor interactive mosaic sundial.
Students at Howe Pre-K celebrated Martin Luther King Jr.'s dream. They learned about his work for civil rights and participated in several creative projects. They hung their work on the school walls for all to see.
That was this month's snapshots, a look at just a few of the many, many positive happenings in our school system.
It's time for more Your School News, so let's send it back over to our news anchor, Allison Helms.
Thank you, Hannah and Julia, and welcome everyone to Your School News here on The Morning Show. 7 years ago, Parsley's class of 2010 put together a time capsule of memorabilia that was reflective of their fifth grade year. Last week, 46 of those students, who are now seniors in high school, returned to open the capsule and retake their class photo. Many of their parents, as well as the media, joined in for a trip down memory lane. Included in the time capsule were class reflections of their last year in elementary school that included newsletters, collages, and lists of what they felt were historical moments from that year. The movie Avatar and the invention of silly bands was a reoccurring theme to that year's group of fifth grade students. Students also remember the earthquake in Haiti and the school-wide beach cleanup project. It was a fun afternoon as students greeted friends that they hadn't seen in years, looked over the items in the time capsule, and talked with former teachers and other staff members. The NC Department of Public Instruction has announced the dropout rates for public school districts across the state. New Hanover County Schools' dropout rate for 2015 to 2016 school year continues to improve as it has for the past 3 years. The dropout rate for our district is 1.65% for the 2015-2016 academic year, which is a decrease from previous year's rate of 1.92%. In 2013 to 2014, the NHCS dropout rate was 1.91%. Improving the graduation rate and preventing dropouts are the top priorities for New Hanover County Schools. In addition to the work with students each day in the schools, the district's dropout prevention committee, comprised of high school principals and central office administrators, is ongoing and focused to helping students complete their high school studies. The committee meets monthly and discusses dropout prevention issues such as behavior, mental health, discipline, and data analysis. After hearing a presentation on the topic of the month, the group works in small teams to develop strategies and action plans to help individual students who need extra support. School public relations professionals across the state are honored annually for the products of their craft during the North Carolina School Public Relations Association's Blue Ribbons Award Ceremony. This year's awards banquet was held in Greensboro with school districts across the state participating. New Hanover County Schools Public Relations Division, which includes NHCS TV, was honored with 9 Blue Ribbon Achievement Awards in 6 different categories. In digital media engagement, the superintendent's blog won a bronze award. In electronic media, Diversity Matters and a PSA for Lake Forest Academy won bronze award. For excellence in writing, the systems employee, Newsletter Waves, was a bronze award. In the marketing category, the PR division's Faith Outreach Program won a Gold Award, and the PR division's anti-bullying campaign won a Silver Award. For publications, the district's strategic plan 2016-2020 vision took home a Silver Award. While under the special events category, the district's 2016 convocation and superintendent's coffee talks both won Silver Awards. Entries were judged by public relations practitioners from the Georgia School Public Relations Association. That's all for now. To watch this week's edition of Your School News online, visit the school system's website at www.nhcs.net and click on the NHCS logo on the homepage. Now back over to Hannah and Julia.
Thanks, Allison. We close our show with an exciting game we call Prevent the Poisoning.
This game will test our knowledge of poison prevention.
Let's send it back over to Allison, who has all the game rules.
Here are the rules. It's simple, stay alive. I will ask a question about poison and poison prevention. If you get it right, you continue on. If you get it wrong, your smiley face gets poisoned. Get poisoned 3 times and a smiley dies. We have 12 questions and we'll play until they are all used up or until your first smiley dies. Can you survive? Okay, contestants, are you ready? Hannah, you have question 1. Which of these toxic substances is blamed for the most fatal unintentional poisonings in the United States? A, lead, B, carbon monoxide, C, bleach, C, B, venom, or D, bleach?
C.
C, B, venom is correct. Okay, Julia, flushing expired medicine down the toilet is what? A, the proper way to dispose of it, B, can poison water, C, should only be done if it has expired by over a year, or D, all of the above?
B.
B is correct. Okay, Hannah, question 3. How can you reduce the risk of a child's accidental poisoning by medication? A, never refer to the medicine as candy. B, keep medicines in their original containers. C, avoid taking medicine in front of children, or D, all of the above?
D, all of the above.
That is correct. Okay. Julia, question 4. If your child eats or drinks a toxic substance, what should you do? A, call the poison control center. B, give your child syrup or Epec. I don't know how to pronounce that word. Or C, wait and see what happens before calling your health care provider. Or D, give your child milk.
A.
That is correct. Okay, question 5. How can you prevent the accidental poisoning of a child outdoors? A, only let them play in the backyard. B, allow them to eat mushrooms. C, teach your children not to eat berries that grow in the yard. Or D, none of the above.
D? Oh, no, wait, I changed my answer. C is what I meant, C.
The correct answer is C.
Okay.
Question 6. A potential poison is A, a product that is labeled poison, B, a liquid that is harmful to children, or C, a substance that is misused. Any substance that is misused.
That's all I have?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
A, B, or C.
A?
That is incorrect. The correct answer was C.
Wait, what was the question?
The question was a potential poison is, and then it said different.
Okay. Oh, okay.
Question 7. Hannah, a cover design for household products and medications which is designed for safety is A, a pop top, B, a child resistant cap, C, a screw lid, or D, a bottle cap?
B.
That is correct. Question 8. Syrup of ipecac is a type of cough medicine. B, neutralizes poison. C, should never be used without talking to the poison center. Or D, is put on burns.
B?
No, the correct answer was C, should never be used without talking to the poison center.
Oh, my poor smiley face.
Oh my gosh. Okay. Question 9. How many children are admitted to the emergency departments each year due to medication poisoning? Is it A, 53,000, B, 71,000, C, 80,000, or D, 92,000? So again, that's how many children are admitted to the ER room each year due to medication poisoning.
C.
No, the correct answer was B, 71,000. Okay. Question 10. How many people die each year from unintentional poisoning? A, a little over 80 people. B, a little over 100 people. C, a little over 130 people. Or D, a little over 150 people.
I'm gonna guess C.
The correct answer was A, a little over 80 people.
Oh.
Oh. Okay. I guess that means you're dead.
Yep, I think so.
All right. And our game winner is Hannah. Congratulations.
Good game, Julia.
Good game, Hannah. Well, that does it for this edition of The Morning Show.
Remember, for the best TV of all, each and every day, keep it tuned right here for New Hanover County Schools TV on the Learning Network.
Have a great day.
And a wonderful week.